Today on Studio One, water skiing is a sport that requires water, a person, and skis. We'll show you how some people take the skis out of the equation. Also, it's hard to resist the temptation to ride a carousel as a kid. We'll spend a day in the life of someone who gets to spread smiles every day. And the news team will introduce you to a woman who discovered her winter blues were something more serious.
From the University of North Dakota, with Monty Cashel and Ivy Arneson, this is Studio One.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to Studio One.
Yes, thank you for joining us today.
We've got a terrific show lined up for you today with a lot of very interesting stories, so let's jump right in.
Sounds good.
The family farm has long been a symbol of strength in the Midwest. We'll meet one man whose farming days came to an abrupt end after a devastating accident.
Also, we'll talk to someone who can put your taste buds into seventh heaven. He'll share some interesting recipes for the holiday season.
But first, today's news with Leanna Anderson.
Thanks, Monty and Ivy. After 3 months of captivity, Western Aid workers, including two Americans, are experiencing their first day of freedom. Heather Mercer and Dana Curry are among those who were arrested for preaching Christianity in Afghanistan. As the news of the rescue spreads, relatives, friends, and church members celebrated by cheering, hugging, and crying. Their release came after the Taliban regime began to crumble. 16 Afghan aid workers were also freed when the Northern Alliance entered Kabul. Even though the U.S. has made military progress in Afghanistan, U.S. officials warn the war on terror is just beginning. White House Press Secretary Ari Fleischer says the pursuit of the Al-Qaeda terrorist network could last years. He says they will not stop until they find the people responsible for the attack on the U.S. President Bush administration officials say they believe significant progress has been made in Afghanistan. However, they say the fall of the Taliban is a secondary goal in many ways. Ever since September 11th, many people have been afraid to get back onto airplanes. Airlines around the country are starting to offer deals to entice people to fly again. Many of the deals are 50% off the normal fare. Others offer companion discounts and rates that include hotel accommodations. Some do not think these promotions will provide enough of a boost to get the industry back to what it was before the attacks.
There's just too many people out there, especially the elderly people, that just do not want to get on planes. They're getting in the car and driving.
Just when travelers were starting to get more confident about flying, the recent plane crash near New York City has brought back many people's fears about the airline industry. The country is currently facing its highest rate of unemployment in 21 years. A big reason is the terrorist attacks. The Labor Department says the events of September 11th affected every part of the economy, not just airlines, hotels, and other travel-dependent industries. The weak economy means places that usually need extra holiday help won't be hiring this season. Retailers who typically start adding jobs for the holidays in October instead cut more than 80,000 jobs last month. Other U.S. businesses slashed more than 400,000 jobs. Most Americans are leading longer, healthier lives. But for many living in rural communities, this is not the case. In many areas, there is a serious lack of convenient health care facilities.
People in rural communities are more likely to die young. According to a new government report, there is a health care problem in U.S. rural areas. Clinics and medical facilities are often miles away, and in emergency situations, it takes too long to get help. In one county in North Dakota, a new clinic has opened, which will make it easier to see a doctor. The facility in Lakota is a satellite clinic from a nearby town, who felt putting the clinic here would benefit the residents.
Our patients will consist of all the people in Lakota and surrounding community of Nelson County. So whoever wants to have an option to be seen by other physicians like us, then we are here to serve them.
Lakota resident Norma Lang says she would drive 28 miles to a neighboring town before the clinic opened. She says the clinic has made her work as a voluntary paramedic easier.
I'm on the ambulance a lot and I can't leave town. So when they schedule an appointment, I have to make sure I'm not on call so I can leave to go to Mackville, and this way I can be on call and still go to the appointment.
She has noticed the difference for other members of the community too.
I was talking to a friend of mine and she said it's going to cut off 20 miles one way for her.
Although this clinic is fulfilling one rural community's needs, there are many others that need help making sure their residents receive adequate health care. Reporting for Studio One News, this is Anita Ramdhari.
The government is planning to address the problem and fund more projects like the one in Lakota. And that's news for now. Monty and Ivy?
Thanks a lot, Leanna.
Well, why don't we go check out the weather with Ryan Vipond at the Regional Weather Information Center.
Hi, Monty and Ivy. Another warm day across the region today, but it looks like this weather pattern will begin to change. First of all, taking a look at our almanac for today in Grand Forks, North Dakota. Low temperature this morning was 38 degrees, well above normal for this time of year. We topped out at 58, so not quite a record today, and our sunset tonight at 4:52 p.m. Currently here in Grand Forks with a clear sky, we see our temperature at 55 degrees, relative humidity 41%, north-northeast winds light, and our pressure at 30.01 inches. Regionally, as far as temperatures go across the upper Midwest and northern plains, very mild for this time of year. Temperatures for the most part in the upper 50s into the mid-60s, 60 degrees in Fargo, 60 over in Minot, 12 in Regina, 58 in Duluth, and 68 over in Cedar Rapids. Currently, our surface analysis does show a trough or a low over the sections of Lake Superior, but the main story here, flooding rains and even tornadoes in Texas this afternoon, so those folks having to deal with a lot of precipitation and weather flying into our region, the upper Midwest and northern plains. Trough just moving through the central sections of Minnesota, leaving us with a mostly sunny sky. And as we move on into the daytime hours tomorrow, our forecast shows warm southerly breezes back into our region through central and western eastern North Dakota, as well as western Minnesota. Very warm for this time of year. Record possibly temperatures will be seen tomorrow. Friday's detailed forecast here in Grand Forks, a mostly sunny sky. Temperatures of 37 degrees for a low and 61 for a daytime high. Again, plenty of sun, very mild southerly winds at 10 to 15 miles per hour. Our weather IQ question for today looks like this. Most airline cancellations and delays are the result of thunderstorms near the runways, gusty crosswinds, dense fog, or heavy snowstorms. We'll have the answer to this weather IQ question plus a detailed look at the extended forecast later in the show. Monty and Ivy.
Thanks a lot, Ryan. Well, hopefully people will get out and enjoy this weather that we're having.
Perfect opportunity to do that.
It is.
Well, let's go now to sports news with James DeGelder.
Thanks, Monty and Ivy. Wednesday's NHL game in New York is one Eric Lindros has been looking forward to since the season began. It'd be the first time he got the chance to face off against his former team. Late first, no score until Fleury gets a puck to Lindros, who scores his ninth goal of the season, 1-0 Rangers. Early third period, 2-1 Rangers, and Roy makes some nifty moves and scores a game-tying goal. Minutes later, Rangers on a power play, and York gets a puck back to Fleury, who scores the goal. Rangers win 4-2. NBA action, Bucks at Wizards. Jordan has the ball and drives in for the easy slam. The Wizards take an early 14-10 lead. Now fourth quarter, Cassell has the ball and makes a tough jumper to extend Milwaukee's lead. The Milwaukee Bucks would win 107-98. College hoops, Oklahoma visiting Michigan State. Early second, and Ira buries the trade at pulled Sooners within one. Now 5 minutes later, and Tolbert pulls up and drains a big three. Michigan State would go on to win 67-55. Hard hits were one of Mike Singletary's trademarks when he played for the Super Bowl champion Chicago Bears in 1985. Today, the Hall of Famer is known for speaking about his Christian faith at banquets across the nation. Coming from a broken home, Singletary says he learned at a young age that prayer was very important. Both he and his mother believe their devotion to God is one of the main things that got them through those tough times. Singletary always told her that he would make things better for her and their family.
We need to be. And I remember her looking at me and saying, son, you know, that's good. You just go to school. You just continue learning and just continue to let God lead you.
Singletary went on to graduate from Baylor University and became one of the greatest defensive players in NFL history. It's now time for the Studio One Sports trivia question. This week's question is, which baseball star played in the most World Series games? Is it Mantle, Rose, Mays, or Berra? And the answer to that and more sports will come in the second half of the show. Monty and Ivy.
Thank you, James. We found a group of people who actually listened to their mothers when they told them to eat their vegetables. They've made eating vegetables a way of life.
Also, strength and perseverance can pull people through the worst of times. We'll talk with someone who faced the fight of his life in a tragic farming accident.
University of North Dakota College of Business and Public Administration offers real degrees for real people. Our nationally recognized faculty can help you earn a master's degree in business through evening classes.
Taking these evening classes, we're very convenient for me, and that's how I was able to complete the program.
We offer degrees for people who work, raise families, and lead busy lives. The UND College of Business and Public Administration, real degrees for real people.
Let the University of North Dakota become your strategic partner by providing your business with skills to enhance your workforce retention and productivity efforts. The UND Office of Workforce Development has extensive experience in conducting employee satisfaction research, workforce needs assessments, and the development of customized training materials. Call us for further information. Workforce Development, a service of the Division of Continuing Education at the University of North Dakota.
The University of North Dakota. You can go anywhere from here. At UND, you'll find a challenging, exciting community that draws students from across the nation and around the world. The University of North Dakota offers 136 programs with outstanding faculty who will prepare you for your future. UND, an affordable, high-quality education that's nationally ranked. Your future starts here. Visit our campus and join the University of North Dakota community.
You're watching Studio One from the University of North Dakota in Grand Forks.
You may have grown up on a farm or know someone who has. The machinery used to make a living as a farmer is a necessity. Sometimes accidents with farm machinery are a tragic reality. John Thompson survived such an accident and is here to tell us how it has changed his life. Thank you for coming on the show today,
John. Thanks for having me.
Well, take us back to the day that your accident happened. What happened that day?
Oh, it was just a plain January 11th day in 1992. And what happened was I was unloading barley from our grain truck into an auger, which was hooked up to the tractor with a PTO shaft. I didn't have my shirt tucked in all the way. And so the front of the shirt is what they think happened. It got caught in the shaft. As I reached down to pull my shirt out, when I pulled it, tightened it up more and wrapped my arms up with it. Then I spun on the shaft a few times and my arms ripped off. And then I hit the ground and was knocked unconscious. And then my dog was licking my face and woke me up. And I kind of lay there and knew something was wrong, but I didn't know exactly what. I thought my one arm was broke. So I was trying to look for it and I couldn't see it, so I thought it was broke behind me. And I was trying to push myself out with my left arm and I wasn't moving. I looked over and realized that it was missing. Then I looked back at the right one and noticed something was gone also. And then I put my back against the tractor tire and stood up and looked at myself again and realized what had happened and just started screaming for just a couple split seconds. And then I completely relaxed and walked to the house and got in the house by getting down on my knees and biting the doorknob with my mouth and turning it. Got in the house and grabbed a pencil with my teeth and dialed for an ambulance or for help. I had to call my cousin. And then got off the phone with her and went and sat in the bathtub. Because I was still bleeding a lot, so I was getting blood everywhere. So I went and sat in the bathtub, so I wouldn't ruin everything. And just waited for my aunt to show up. And
so when all these events are, when you're talking, you've probably told the story a million times, and it's all a matter of fact now. But just listening to the events as they're unfolding, it's just amazing that you were able to keep a cool head while you were doing this. When did you realize the extent of the accident?
When I stood up and looked at myself again, then I kind of freaked out. But luckily I had my dog with me, because he's the one that woke me up, plus he's standing right in front of me. And when I started screaming, he just kind of looked at me and tilted his head, and I just relaxed then.
Okay. Now, after the accident and you got help, you got taken to the hospital, they wanted to reattach your arms, and they were able to do that. Now, how often is this magnitude of a reattachment accomplished?
I'm the first one.
You're the very first one.
There's been three of them where it's been removed or you've been amputated above the elbows. But I'm the first one to have real good movement back.
What did the doctor say when you came in and you need to get your arms reattached?
They asked me what I wanted to do. They said we can either attach them or leave them off. And I said, well, I'm here, you might as well put them on. And which were my exact words, I believe. And then he went through and said, this is what's going to happen if we put them on, and you're probably get an infection. There's a good chance you're going to lose them anyway. There's a good chance you can die and all this kind of stuff. And if you leave them off, you'll be at the hospital pretty soon. And we, decided to keep him on anyway, so.
Okay. Now, when you were in the hospital, how long were you there, and what was the recovery process like for you?
I was there for 6 weeks the first time. Then I was in and out for different surgeries and be there for a few days, and so.
Okay. Now, was there ever a time when you were, during the recovery process, that you thought maybe I can't do this anymore?
When I was getting to be a lot of press around all the time, every time I went to the hospital, every time I went to Minneapolis, I'd have to have people at the airport waiting for me to pick me up, because I always have reporters trying to get in there, so I have to kind of sneak in and out of the cities all the time. And it just got to be a lot of stress trying to deal with people chasing me around and, you know, hiding in the backseat vehicles when I go somewhere. And it got to be a lot. Every time I went to therapy, you know, reporters were always following me around, so they'd go with me, and it really got tired just having people following me all the time.
Was that difficult, getting into the limelight like that?
Extremely. You know, I was from rural North Dakota, a town of 100 people, and, you know, in high school, I wouldn't go and talk in my speech class in front of two of my classmates. I'd be too nervous. You know, now I'll speak in front of, you know, I've done a stadium with 70,000 people on it, and it doesn't bother me a bit.
Yeah.
So.
Now, what were some of the things that kept you going through all this?
I really don't know. Just being stubborn, and I just kind of let things happen as they happen. I never set goals for myself. Whatever I got back, I got back. Whatever didn't happen, didn't happen. I didn't get too upset about it. I think that's one of the main things. I just kind of let things go as they went. I wasn't too pushy about anything.
Yeah. Now, what about your family? What were some of their reactions to you while you were going through this?
My family felt very guilty about it. They blamed themselves for not having the safety shield on the auger, and which would cost $50. But, you know, we never think about it. No farmer does. And so they had a lot of guilt that they had to deal with. And they got a lot of bad letters from people. Like, when I went to school, they were mad. People were upset that they didn't sell the farm, move to Bismarck with me, or, you know, they think I should have stayed at home. My parents would be with me all the time. And, you know, my parents had a really, really hard time with everything.
Were they able to get past that?
I think they're starting to. The public was really critical of my family. Yeah. I mean, they were supposed to be there all the time, and, you know, I didn't want my family around me, so.
Yeah. Now, you wrote a book about your whole experience, and it's out now. And in this book, you say, the old you died that day. What did you mean by that?
Well, it's kind of a funny thing, because it just kind of happened. I didn't even notice it. But they start asking me questions about me before the accident. I start referring to, well, he was like this, or he was like that. And they kept, well, who's he? And I'm like, well, I mean me before the accident. And I just kind of started referring to him as some totally else. And basically, he just died in that accident. And I mean, there's no similarity at all between the two of us. I mean, totally different people.
Why did you write the book?
Well, when I was in the hospital, I had people calling for books and for the movie rights, and I wasn't ready to do either one. And Victoria Principal, who's a good friend of mine, she called me quite a bit. And she's the one that convinced me to do the book, and she really pushed me to get the book done. And she's pretty much the one that got me to do it. And I decided that it was time to get it done. You know, it's been almost 10 years, and I hired a writer, and we hurried up and finished it.
So what are you working on now? Any other projects in the works?
They've been wanting me to write a second book now for a couple of years before this one was even done. And probably next year we'll probably be doing a movie. But that's not for sure yet. So, but right now I'm just running around touring with this right now.
All right. Well, John, it's an incredible story, and the book is out in bookstores now. Thanks a lot for coming on the show and sharing it with us.
Thank you.
All right. Coming up, we'll preview Robert Redford's latest film. We'll see how he and Brad Pitt collaborated in a carefully planned out plot. Music, laughter, and shiny animals are what makes this job interesting. We'll find out how one woman combines fun and work into her day.
UND's Conflict Resolution Center is your regional training resource for conflict transformation and prevention. Conflict is inevitable in the business world. Your ability to manage it is key to your success. That's where we can help. We provide on-site training, mediation, and facilitation services customized for your organization. The UND Conflict Resolution Center, capturing the positive energy of conflict and transforming it into human potential.
Why should I go to the University of North Dakota School of Engineering and Mines? Is it the small class sizes and personal attention I'll get from the faculty and staff? Is it the hands-on student projects my friends and I will work on? Is it the professional internship programs that'll help me prepare for my future career? Maybe I just want to be a part of something amazing.
Find out for yourself what makes the UND School of Engineering and Mines the perfect choice for your engineering degree.
Call 1-800-CALL-UND. That's 1-800-CALL-UND.
The University of North Dakota has a rich history of retaining and graduating American Indian students. UND offers 26 American Indian programs, more than any other higher education institution in the U.S. The support services provided by Native American programs enhance student success. Native American programs offer tutoring, academic advising, and financial aid assistance, which makes UND a leader in Indian education. For more information, call 1-800-CALL-UND.
The School of Law at the University of North Dakota. This is a unique place, a place where you can learn with some of the best technology, where you can talk to the faculty in small class settings, a place where student activity groups enhance your education, a place which offers interaction with the court system, an affordable place where you can gain all the skills you need to get a job. Take your place at the University of North Dakota School of Law. Phone 1-800-CALL-UND.
Most people agree you can't get much for a dollar these days. We found one woman who devotes her days to turning a single dollar into a smile. We'll spend the day in the life of a carousel operator.
A day filled with colorful animals, cheerful music, and smiling faces. For Mary Flores, it's all in a day's work. Mary works as a carousel operator in a mall in Grand Forks, North Dakota. She says she has the perfect job.
I love kids, and I love to see those faces, so that's why I like, you know, doing this.
Mary says the smiles from all the different kids are the best part. Of course, she does have her favorites.
There's a little kid that comes in every day. This one right here. Just, she makes that face, and I love to see her.
Mary's in charge of the entire carousel operation. From admission, to crowd control, to assigned seating, she does it all.
Okay.
And always, service with a smile.
All right, here we go.
Mary is certainly not the only one who is delighted by the carousel.
I'm riding on a dolphin! Hi!
Four-year-old Kylie certainly enjoys herself. In fact, she can't get enough. There are a few customers who don't fully appreciate their carousel ride. But most everyone who spends a little time with Mary and a little pocket change for a ride leaves with a smile and the satisfaction that it was a dollar well spent. With photographer Brian Jones, this is Kelly Anderson reporting for Studio One.
Mary says the carousel attracts mostly young children, but she once helped an 85-year-old woman take a ride on one of her horses. With an exceptional cast like Robert Redford and Brad Pitt, the new film Spy Game is sure to draw a crowd. Redford plays a veteran CIA officer who is a day away from retiring. He learns his protege, played by Brad Pitt, has been charged with espionage. Pitt's character has only 24 hours to live. Cast members say the plot plays out like a game of strategy.
The story is kind of a chess game, and it's just very intelligent in the way it's laid out, meaning a move will be made, and we're not sure what the strategy is behind it, but two scenes later it catches up with us. So it keeps unfolding in this way.
Spy Game required some intense on-location filming. Some of the scenes were shot in Hungary and Morocco, while crucial scenes were filmed in England. Spy Game opens November 21st. And now time to look at the events happening in your area.
The Thanksgiving holiday is approaching. It's a time when we can reflect on the things for which we are truly thankful. With that holiday approaching, we wanted your thankful thoughts.
I'm probably most thankful for just good friends and family, I guess. Reason why is just that's probably the main part of your life.
I am most thankful for my family and my friends.
I'm thankful that we have a country where freedom is so important to us.
Well, I have to say probably my family back in Colorado and being a cadet of the United States Army with in light of all the recent events.
My family, because they are very supportive and they're always there for me.
God's blessed me with great provisions, you know, and a good job.
Without the friends from UND, I wouldn't have learned as much as I have. And I love you guys. You're the best.
A day without meat or milk products can be hard to imagine for some, but for vegans, this is a way of life. This alternative lifestyle can make a difference in a person's health and their overall well-being.
Soy eggnog is already on the shelves for the Christmas season at the Amazing Grain Store. Soy is a good source of calcium and protein, and for vegans, it is a good food supplement.
A vegan is a person who doesn't eat any animal products. That includes milk products and eggs. They don't eat honey even, and obviously no meat or fish.
With eliminating all food that deals with animals, vegans need to make sure they get enough nutrients. Nuts, seeds, and rice, along with soy, help vegans get the basic essentials. A popular soy product with vegans is tofu. Tofu can be baked, marinated, put in a stir fry, and even into puddings. Other products are also available for vegans, like vegan cheese, vegan pepperoni, and even vegan mayonnaise. Vegans can make their own version of an egg salad sandwich with wheat bread, tofu, and veganaise. Cholesterol is completely eliminated from the diet, and people with heart disease, allergies, and asthma can benefit from this alternative life.
Our program is really set up for a total lifestyle change. Veganism is only one part of a total lifestyle change. The other lifestyle changes would include things like exercise, fresh air, sunlight, rest.
With so many alternatives for food, Betsy makes it clear.
Life is not over for vegans.
If you are one of those people that love your milkshake and cheeseburger, veganism may not suit your appetite. This is Bethany Denny reporting for Studio One.
Amazing Grains makes sandwiches with vegan products that they say can fool most anyone's taste buds. Vegan groups also meet monthly to exchange recipes and try new foods. You've probably heard of the winter blues. The news team will tell us how this can actually become a disorder. Plus, we'll find out how some people are taking water sports to the extreme. Look, Ma, no skis. That story plus news, sports, and the updated weather forecast in the next half hour of Studio One.
Students from any major can build a great future through the entrepreneurship programs at the College of Business and Public Administration at the University of North Dakota.
It lets them meet with business people and spread their wings and do the research to see if their ideas really do work.
Well, this program is for everybody. Business coincides and integrates with any major out there.
Trust yourself. Take action. Discover the entrepreneurship programs at the UND College of Business and Public Administration.
Explore the educational opportunities available through the Division of Continuing Education at the University of North Dakota. With just one phone call or a click of the mouse, you'll find high-quality programs designed for today's adults. We have a large selection of continuing education courses that are available at a time and place that's convenient for you. Discover a world of learning through the Division of Continuing Education at the University of North Dakota.
Future a bit cloudy? Get a brighter picture at UND Aerospace in the University of North Dakota. World-class training programs endorsed by major airlines, an extraordinary fleet of aircraft, and learning facilities second to none make UND Aerospace the largest collegiate aviation program in North America. Begin your future in the aviation industry. Explore programs in space studies or computer science. Soar into the atmospheric sciences. It's all here at UND Aerospace. What's in your future? UND Aerospace, clearly the leader in aviation education.
Are you a parent looking for child care? Do you know what good child care looks like? Do you provide child care and have questions? Does child care affect your business? Do you have employees who are concerned about child care? Doesn't every child deserve quality child care? Any questions? Call Child Care Resource and Referral.
Watching Studio One from the University of North Dakota in Grand Forks.
Welcome back to Studio One.
Thank you for joining us today.
Well, Monty, Thanksgiving is just around the corner, mm-hmm. and a lot of people don't know it, but the modern Thanksgiving comes from actually three different things in early history.
Really?
The first one was the first Thanksgiving with the Pilgrims and Native Americans, and that was a non-religious event. And the second tradition, which our modern Thanksgiving came from, was the Puritan Day of Thanksgiving. And the third tradition was one that people used to celebrate a specific event, like a battle or a war that had been won or something. So all three of those combined to what is now our modern-day Thanksgiving.
And that's why we have Thanksgiving
Yes,
today.
It is.
Well, thank you for that information.
You're welcome.
Coming up in the next 30 minutes on Studio One, long winters in the upper Midwest can sometimes make many people feel depressed. We'll tell you how, for some, it can become much more serious.
Also, sunshine, warm weather, and bare feet are some things that you might need if you're planning on doing this water sport. Later, we'll watch some amazing stunts on the water.
And some say being surrounded by family can make your holiday meal complete. Well, we'll talk with someone who can make the food just as special. But first, today's news with Leanna Anderson.
Thanks, Monty and Ivy. President Bush and Russian President Vladimir Putin made progress on many issues during Putin's visit to the U.S., but not on U.S. plans for missile defense. 3 days of informal discussions wrapped up today, with both leaders speaking to students at a Texas high school. At their meeting in Texas, Bush had hoped to convince Putin to abandon or modify the 1972 anti-ballistic missile treaty. This treaty bans national missile defenses, and Russia views it as a centerpiece for world stability. Meanwhile, an airline security bill may be through Congress by the end of the week. The bill has been approved by both Republican and Democratic leadership in the Senate and the House. The bill would require the nation's airports to put federal employees in charge of security screening for the next 3 years. After this time, airports would be able to hire either private contractors or state and local law enforcement. Republicans had opposed making airline workers federal employees, while Democrats supported the idea. The federal government recently ordered several states to toughen their sex offender registration laws or risk losing federal grant money. They want them to be consistent with Megan's Law, which says that law enforcement agencies must release information on a sex offender if there is a risk of reoffense. North Dakota was one of the states ordered to strengthen its laws and has recently done so.
North Dakota is in compliance with the federal laws and Megan's Law. However, it's one thing to pass that law, but then it's the implementation of that where there's sometimes holes.
Work is now underway to enforce the law more uniformly across the state. In addition, the state now has a website where people can find information on the registered offenders in their area. The site provides an address and photo of each offender required to register for life. Some companies are trying to make money off anxiety caused by anthrax. One firm has invented a product for those concerned with opening their mail. The device is the size of a perfume box and is designed to fill mailboxes with invisible germ-killing ions. Another company created a mail opener box. It comes with a sealable lid and two openings with attached rubber gloves, so you can handle the mail without actually touching it. Some experts say these products may be gimmicks. They say people shouldn't use the products unless they are recommended by the government. Many Americans have a hard time making it through the winter months, but it has nothing to do with the cold and snow. People who have seasonal affective disorder get depressed because they crave sunlight.
And they will be put outside of the...
When winter comes and the nights draw in, Heather Larson feels the change in an unusual way. She suffers from seasonal affective disorder, or SAD. SAD is when a person becomes depressed because they miss the sunlight. An incident 4 years ago made Larson realize she needed help.
First initial time that I really understood that there was something wrong with me was I was getting all my Christmas decorations out. And I sobbed the entire time I was taking my Christmas decorations out. And I couldn't find any concrete reason, but I knew that I just felt horrible inside.
With help from doctors, it became clear that she was missing the sun.
And that's when they made the connection. It was right before Christmas, meaning we had lost quite a bit of light up to that point. And they kind of put two and two together because come April, I feel like a whole different person again.
To combat her disorder, Heather followed some simple professional advice.
For one thing, don't hibernate. Don't be a bear. Don't stay inside. Exercise. Get some sleep. Sleep regularly. Keep your usual routine. Don't withdraw socially. If people invite you out, go along.
Some people with SAD also use a special light, which simulates sunlight. As a mother, lecturer, and full-time grad student, it is essential for Larson to keep her SAD under control.
I try to exercise a lot. Exercise makes a big difference. And then sooner or later, again, if it gets bad enough, I go in and they put me on an antidepressant for the couple months during the winter.
Larson has lived with seasonal affective disorder for several years, and through her determination, it no longer interferes with her life. Reporting for Studio One News, this is Anita Ramdhari.
People with SAD may respond to different treatments. Experts say if a person is suffering from seasonal affective disorder, they should see their doctor to determine what will work for them. And that's news for today. Monty and Ivy?
Thanks a lot, Leanna. Well, the days are getting shorter.
Yes, they are. Well, why don't we go see what the weather is doing at the Regional Weather Information Center with Ryan Vipond.
Hi, Monty and Ivy. Well, in fact, you are right. The days are getting shorter, and you would think with that happening, the day is getting cooler, but not the case. Still warm and mild out there. First of all, taking a look at our current conditions here in Grand Forks, we see our temp has dropped to 48 degrees now with a mostly clear sky. Relative humidity sits at 73%, northeast winds at 8 now. Taking a look at our jet stream analysis out there for today, the ridge still in place across the western half of the country, keeping those folks in the mild region regime. As we put this map into motion, the trough develops over the upper Midwest, sending some cooler air into our region the end of the weekend and at the beginning of next week. So temperatures back to near normal for mid-November. Our extended forecast for Grand Forks, mostly sunny and 61 for Friday. And the cool down begins, look at that high on Monday with a partly cloudy sky, only 29 degrees. So certainly a major cool down in place. Our weather IQ question and answer looks like this. Airline cancellations and delays are the result of... And if you answer dense fog, you are correct. Something we've been accustomed to here the last few days in the region with dense fog. Looks like that's not in the forecast, but certainly a major cool down on the way the end of the weekend. Monty and Ivy?
Thanks a lot, Ryan. Well, I don't know about the cool down, but hopefully people will get out and enjoy this.
Well,
the
we
nice
can.
Weather.
It's coming. Winter's coming. Well, let's go now to sports news with James DeGelder.
Thanks, Monty and Ivy. A new threat lurks among the deer herds that roam across the upper Midwest. This threat isn't a newly introduced predator or a new rifle for hunters, but it comes in the form of a deadly disease.
This is Paul Metzger. He is one of more than 500,000 hunters across North Dakota and Minnesota who are taking aim at bagging a deer. But this season, he might need to be on the lookout for more than just a trophy buck. All hunters are being asked to watch out for deer that are showing signs of chronic wasting disease, or CWD for short. According to North Dakota Game and Fish Officer Gary Rankin, CWD affects deer much like mad cow disease.
Weakness, loss of body weight, emaciated in final stages. They may be staggering, shaky.
The only part of the country to have confirmed reports of CWD is an area that includes the Nebraska Panhandle and bordering sections of Colorado and Wyoming. Even though there have been no reports in the northern Midwest of CWD, officials are still on the lookout.
If there are any suspected animals that are found, samples are taken, they're tested.
Many hunters are not aware of the potential threat of CWD because of the small area that has been directly affected.
I'm not sure how it spreads or what the disease actually is.
If not properly dealt with, CWD could cause a large problem for the deer population across the country. And to make sure they're doing their part to help deal with the disease, hunters like Metzger will need to report deer who are acting strangely to their local wildlife officials. For Studio One Sports, I'm John Randall.
The Minnesota Department of Natural Resources collected 500 deer heads during the recent deer hunting season. The DNR tested the animals to ensure there have not been any infections of CWD in their state. It's now time for the answer to this week's Studio One Sports trivia question. This week's question is, which baseball star played in the most World Series games? We gave you some tough choices, and the answer is Yogi Berra. He played in 75 World Series games for the New York Yankees. That's the sports for today. Monty and Ivy.
Thank you, James. Coming up, we'll talk to a man who can help you prepare a wonderful Thanksgiving meal. He'll give us some ideas that you're sure to put in your recipe box.
And water skiing is an exciting summer activity. We found some people who take this sport to the next level without using the skis. That story is next on Studio One.
Address your workforce training needs through the Workforce Training Partnership between Lake Region State College and the University of North Dakota. Both institutions have joined together to provide training in computer applications, management and supervision, the trades, and much more. The partnership also provides customized training programs to fit the specific needs of your business or industry. For more information, contact the Workforce Training Partnership Office at Lake Region State College or the University of North Dakota.
UND's Conflict Resolution Center is your regional training resource for conflict transformation and prevention. Conflict is inevitable in the business world. Your ability to manage it is key to your success. That's where we can help. We provide on-site training, mediation, and facilitation services customized for your organization. The UND Conflict Resolution Center, capturing the positive energy of conflict and transforming it into human potential.
Explore the educational opportunities available through the Division of Continuing Education at the University of North Dakota. With just one phone call or a click of the mouse, you'll find high-quality programs designed for today's adults. We have a large selection of continuing education courses that are available at a time and place that's convenient for you. Discover a world of learning through the Division of Continuing Education at the University of North Dakota.
You're looking at our studio audience, and today we have Lake of the Woods High School here. For many people, traditional water skiing takes time to master. If you think that is hard, try standing up without any skis. One man has been doing it for most of his life and is now considered the best in the world.
Flying across a glassy sheet of water on your bare feet may seem crazy to some people. Just wait until you fall down at speeds more than 40 miles an hour. Like many other extreme sports, barefoot water skiing began as an underground sport. Pioneers of the sport wanted to take traditional water skiing to a different level. Barefooting has been officially recognized as a sport since 1961 and is now practiced throughout the world. Barefooting is divided into three separate events: slalom, tricks, and jumping. Competitors are judged in each category, and then an overall award is given out to the skier who excels in all three events. In slalom, points are awarded when the skier crosses from one side of the wake to the other. In tricks, skiers have 15 seconds to spin, jump, and twirl as much as they can. The final event, jumping, is a little more wild. Being willing to launch yourself off a ramp at breakneck speeds, hang on to the handle like Superman, and then land on your feet takes a different kind of skier. National championships are held every year. The 2001 Nationals were held in Fergus Falls, Minnesota during August. Ron Scarpa is ranked first overall in the world. He has been barefooting professionally for more than 20 years and is considered one of the best barefooters ever by many skiers. Scarpa says the sport has evolved greatly since he began skiing.
But it has changed just dramatically in every aspect, from boats to wetsuits, ropes, handles, and as far as the level of the skiers.
Although Scarpa is considered the best skier in the world, he says it wasn't always that way.
Winning my first overall title, it took 12 years before I finally did it, you know. And a lot of people thought I never was going to win one.
After he won his first overall world title in 1992, Scarpa has since won that award three times. Scarpa has also been the overall champion at Nationals 11 times, including six straight years from 1991 to 1996. Scarpa says while he loves winning, there's more to it than that.
I really enjoy the training of it, and I like coming and having the big reunion, too.
Skiers who compete against Scarpa say he has an advantage.
A lot of people can go out and do the things in practice, but Ron has the ability to really put it together on the water when it's time to, you know.
Keith St. Ange is Scarpa's main rival. He's second overall in the world and says skiing against Ron has been difficult because he takes skiing to a higher level.
I mean, it's great. He tends to psych a lot of people out and he can get in a lot of people's head. For me, I know we're just really friendly with each other and we let our showmanship do it on the water for us.
Ron is 38 years old and says age doesn't matter when barefooting. He says even though he's been competing for so long, he still gets excited to ski.
It's undescribable or indescribable to someone if they've never ever barefooted. And the fact of the matter is, if you've ever slid across that glassy, smooth lake or river, it's awesome.
Ron says his favorite part is just the calmness he feels when he's on the water.
And just skiing on a nice sheet of smooth water with nothing but your bare feet, there's nothing like it.
Scarpa says barefooting is no longer just his job, but has now become his lifestyle.
I'm fortunate. I'm doing something that I love. It's not really done for fame or for fortune by no means, but, you know, I'm doing something that I like to do that's worth a lot to me.
Ron says he is focusing on the world competitions in Europe in 2002. He hopes to put on a good performance there, but he also plans to lessen the amount he competes over the next couple years.
You know, I want to basically spend more time with my family and not travel quite as much. I'm on the road about 6 months a year right now, and it's just, it's hard. I've got two young girls, and it makes it tough.
Ron finished second overall at this year's Nationals competition, falling to Keith St. Ange. Sliding across the water, knowing his career could end at any moment, is how Ron Scarpa has lived his life since he was 15. If everything goes his way, he will be flying off jumps, spinning like a top, and loving every minute of it until he's old and gray. I'm Corey Morlock, reporting for Studio One.
Corey joins us in the studio to talk a little bit more about his story. Some amazing pictures in there, Corey. It's a good story. I, believe it or not, have tried barefoot water skiing and miserably failed. Fell into the water quite a few times. When you were talking to these pros, how did they learn how to do this?
Well, they all basically said the same thing. They said they all started out on skis, and they kept getting smaller and smaller skis, and eventually the skis got down to just a little bit bigger than their feet. And so then they tried to make the jump over to feet rather than from skis, and, you know, they all said they fell a lot of times, and they got water up their nose, and they were hurting, but they eventually all got it, and now they're pros.
What is the speed that the boat usually travels when they're going?
Usually it's around between 40 and 44 miles an hour. And that's just, it varies for jumps and for tricks and slalom.
All right. Thanks a lot for the story. Stomachs are sure to be growling after what we're going to give you next. We'll show you someone who can prepare a delectable holiday meal.
Let your job experience help you earn a degree in engineering while you continue to work. The University of North Dakota's Distance Engineering Degree Program offers the only ABET-accredited undergraduate degree program at a distance. Instructors and classes are delivered to you through videotape and other technologies.
It allows you to have a class whenever you like.
UND Continuing Education and the School of Engineering and Mines, teaming up to bring quality education to your door.
Future a bit cloudy? Get a brighter picture at UND Aerospace in the University of North Dakota. World-class training programs endorsed by major airlines, an extraordinary fleet of aircraft, and learning facilities second to none make UND Aerospace the largest collegiate aviation program in North America. Begin your future in the aviation industry. Explore programs in space studies or computer science. Soar into the atmospheric sciences. It's all here at UND Aerospace. What's in your future? UND Aerospace, clearly the leader in aviation education.
The School of Law at the University of North Dakota. This is a unique place, a place where you can learn with some of the best technology, where you can talk to the faculty in small class settings, a place where student activity groups enhance your education, a place which offers interaction with the court system, an affordable place where you can gain all the skills you need to get a job. Take your place at the University of North Dakota School of Law. Phone 1-800-CALL-UND.
Why should I go to the University of North Dakota School of Engineering and Mines? Is it the small class sizes and personal attention I'll get from the faculty and staff? Is it the hands-on student projects my friends and I will work on? Is it the professional internship programs that'll help me prepare for my future career? Maybe I just want to be a part of something amazing.
Find out for yourself what makes the UND School of Engineering and Mines the perfect choice for your engineering degree. Call 1-800-CALL-UND. That's 1-800-CALL-UND.
People are always looking for new ways to spruce up their holiday meals. Whether it's simple home cooking or an extravagant meal, we've found a man who can help. Chef Kim Holmes will share some cooking tips with us today. Thank you for coming on the show today,
Kim. Pleasure's mine, believe me. Thanks for having me.
Well, look at all this good food. Why don't we just get right to it, and why don't you tell us how you make all this
right.
Wonderful stuff?
Well, all these recipes are on the website here, so you can pick those up anytime. The cranberry relish is about a 15-20 minute preparation, and it's cranberries and pears, and it refrigerates very well. You can can it, so you do that ahead, 2-3 days, a week ahead. What I've done here is I've done three versions of dressing, four if you stuff the bird with it. This is a basic dressing with carrots, celery, and onions. And you saute those in butter, and then put that in with the breadcrumbs. Now you have to take bread, we use Sanders French bread, and we tear it in pieces, and you have to dry it out.
Okay.
So it soaks up the moisture from the butter and the celery, the carrots, and the onions. And then I add stock to turkey stock to make it a little moister. And then this is all prepared the day ahead. You put it in the fridge and then bake it off on Thanksgiving.
And how long does it take to make the each of these different
dressings? Okay, the dressings take about 30 minutes to an hour, depending on your skills in the kitchen. As you said
earlier.
It might
take me a little bit longer.
And we have a basic dressing, and this dressing I've added cranberries and apples, and this is sausage. So you have three distinct flavors, but it's the base dressing that that I use all the time.
And like you said before, you said you could cook these the night before, and then...
Well, no, you don't cook them the night before. You prepare them the day before,
and
you cook them Thanksgiving Day. You just whip off the foil top, throw it in a preheated oven and relax and enjoy, you know. And then the turkey, you do the day, you clean it and get it ready to go. But you don't stuff it or do anything until that morning.
And do you think the dressing has a better flavor when it's cooked in the turkey or when it's cooked in just a regular outside
it's
of the
turkey? Totally different because here I rub the cavity with garlic puree, white pepper, salt, and then you loosely pack the dressing. You never pack it in hard because you don't want to hurt somebody. You don't want to get them sick.
Right.
And then you also pack it in here, and then I seal it in the back. But
how do you seal it in the back?
Well, I've used toothpicks.
Okay.
See?
And you just pick the...
And you just close them off, and you can put stuffing in here and then stuffing in the front of the bird. And I start the bird with upside down, the breast side down, in a V-rack. That's a V-rack.
Okay.
You start it like that. You cook it and crisp it up for half the cooking time. Then you flip it over, and there you go. And
are you going to show us how to carve this?
Yes, I am going to show you how to carve it. I'm going to take this knife right here.
Oh!
Things flying everywhere. That's showbiz. And we'll cut the leg off like this. And put that on the platter. And my wife won't let me cook at home. That's why I have a restaurant. I'm too messy, she says. Can you imagine that? And then you take the dark meat off and you place it on your platter. And then you take the knife and you cut down at the bottom, just above the wing. And then you start and you carve. You never carve up here and down. You start at the end.
So you get better cuts that way.
You get better cuts and you get more mileage out of your turkey.
Okay. And can you give us some other tips for making a turkey? I know I've never even cooked a turkey before.
Uh-huh.
And I guess, what would a beginner like me, how would I make a good turkey?
You would call somebody in like Hugo's and have them make a turkey. No, I'm just kidding. You make your dressing and... You can stuff the bird, and you, like I say, stuff it loosely, put foil here, toothpick it there. You can, I like to cook it breast side down for half the time.
Okay.
15 minutes a pound, according to my wife. 13 minutes a pound for me. I like it a little bit juicier. She calls it rare. and then halfway through, you flip it over. Now, that's one way. You can... If you have those turkey roasters outside where you drop the whole turkey in oil and you cook it, you get a very crisp skin, very tender. You don't stuff those birds. And you can barbecue it. You can cook it on a Weber. You can smoke it on a Weber where you have indirect heat and you throw some cherry wood. I like cherry wood or red oak or something like that. And then you cook it indirectly, and that takes probably about 15 minutes a pound.
And what's your favorite Thanksgiving dish out of dressings and relish and everything?
Scallop corn.
Scallop corn?
That's one of my favorites, and the dressing, I'd say, would be Probably my very favorite.
And I know it takes a lot of work to prepare a Thanksgiving meal, so is there anything you can, any way people can cut down the time it takes to make them, or is preparing the day before really important?
The recipes I have on the web, on your website, can all be done the day ahead. Not cooked, but prepared. So the art form in Thanksgiving dinner is to have everything ready the day before that needs to be, like the dressing and the scallop corn or the yams. The mashed potatoes should be peeled, diced, and put in water and just pulled out and put on the stove that day. So everything is just popped in the oven, and it's a timing thing. So about an hour and a half before you sit down to dinner, you can cook off everything. The bird will be done. It should be pulled out, and you should let the bird rest for 15 to 20 minutes before you carve it, so all
just
the juices
to cool
don't
down.
Run out.
Okay. Okay. And can you give us any tips for beginning cooks like me? Anything? Any advice?
Well, yes. try it.
Try it.
Just go after it, and don't be intimidated by cooking at all, because it's all a matter of timing, and if you follow recipes, they usually work.
Okay.
All right.
Well, I'm going to have to try some of your wonderful recipes.
Well, that's why I cooked all this food, so I can be asked back again.
Oh, okay.
Last time I didn't cook enough, and it's been 2 years, and I've been so lonely.
Well, there's plenty of food here for everybody. So
yes. So
thanks a lot
for sharing
these good ideas with us, and thank you for coming on the show,
Thanks
Kim.
Thanks for having me, Abby. My pleasure.
All right. You're watching Studio One from the University of North Dakota, and we'll be right back after this.
The University of North Dakota has a rich history of retaining and graduating American Indian students. UND offers 26 American Indian programs, more than any other higher education institution in the U.S. The support services provided by Native American programs enhance student success. Native American programs offer tutoring, academic advising, and financial aid assistance, which makes UND a leader in Indian education. For more information, call 1-800-CALL-UND.
Let your job experience help you earn a degree in engineering while you continue to work. The University of North Dakota's Distance Engineering Degree Program offers the only ABET-accredited undergraduate degree program at a distance. Instructors and classes are delivered to you through videotape and other technologies.
It allows you to have a class whenever you like.
UND Continuing Education and the School of Engineering and Mines, teaming up to bring quality education to your door.
Are you a parent looking for childcare? Do you know what good childcare looks like? Do you provide childcare and have questions? Does childcare affect your business? Do you have employees who are concerned about childcare? Doesn't every child deserve quality child care? Any questions? Call Child Care Resource and Referral.
Valor Insurance partners with you in protecting what matters most. For more than 50 years, Valor has built its reputation on its people, its clients, and a commitment to VIP service. Valor Insurance, Fargo, Bismarck, Grand Forks. Valor Insurance understands that the strength of its people is its greatest asset. People that tailor insurance protection that meets your needs. That's the key to VIP service. Valor Insurance, Fargo, Bismarck, Grand Forks.
Chef Kim Holmes was generous enough to leave us his recipes. You can find them on the Studio One website. The web address will be shown during our closing credits.
Well, we're going to leave you now with some pictures of a carousel ride. Very nice apron, by the way.
Thank you.
From all of us here at Studio One, have a great week.